Although this time, I had to take a back seat and let someone else take the lead.
Okay then, we're really going to be talking about something very sensitive. Homosexuality. Now, my brother, you're activating for homosexuality. You're saying, fine, homosexuality, hip hip hooray.
Every person is talking about homosexuality. People know about it. Your callers would say, we know it. We've met homosexuals.
Yeah. Let me ask you a question.
Yeah. Right?
Does knowing it mean that it's right? Because they know it, does it make it right in any way?
What makes you think it's wrong?
What makes me... The beginning, it was Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. So, really, I don't get it. Okay, yes, my mind might be misplaced at this point, but please correct me if I'm wrong.
Why are you so much against homosexuality? For example, why do you hate homosexuals?
Homosexuality in Africa came in as something like an alien would come.
Yes. What is inciting people to want to embrace homosexuality?
What is inciting people? Yes. What is inciting the LGBT activists?
Those girls are really winding me up. I kind of want to just grab the mic and go, listen! But I just want to hear what they've got to say. But it's really hard to just sit by and not talk. Especially with those girls, they're doing my head in.
God initially created man and woman, not man for man. Give us a call, 0382271891 and 0794271891. Hello.
No, you guys, is it mentioned anywhere that it's okay for man to have sex with a man?
It is not really.
So for me, there is no way you're going to convince me that it is okay to have sex with a fellow man. Sure, for good sex, there is no way.
How does it happen?
So me, I can't concur with you in any way.
In the Western world, 2% to 13%. Assuming this thing has grown, because the way it has acquired.
When you talk about this thing growing.
This thing, because it's a thing to me, it's alien to me.
Yes.
It's like you're looking at in 50 years from now.
No, I'm
like
looking at 10
80%
years.
Of the population will be
that
gay.
That means there's a great
outsider. I'm not saying.
It's as though he wanted to be gay. Now listen, assuming 80% of the population in the world
I'm
is
not
gay,
saying.
Then
I'm
I would give the world 100 years for it to be empty with
I'm
no
not
person.
Saying, I'm not saying.
Who would be giving
Michael,
birth, by the way?
Listen to me.
You
I'm not
imagine.
Saying.
That's
let me tell
very
you.
True. You're breaking what Africa is.
Let me tell you
is,
something. I'm not breaking
if
what
we're fighting,
Africa.
If we're fighting for
Michael,
Africa,
Michael,
we know.
Michael,
if we're fighting for the
me.
Africa.
Michael, this is getting personal.
Yeah,
no,
I'm not fighting for Africa.
If we're fighting for the Africa, we know.
I'm feeling inside myself because I was born like this.
After 2 hours of what I can only describe as a battering, it was all over for Frank.
Wow. How did you feel about that?
I'm pretty much disappointed by the level of homophobia that exists in this region. I think we do, sometimes I flatter myself and I think the journey is not so much, but I think the journey is so big. And I feel so bad that people have to be this homophobic. I mean, almost all the callers where they kill them, arrest them, they are mad, they are dirty.
I was very disappointed as well. I really thought that this would be different, that maybe we get a more positive response. But all I heard was the same old bigoted views. It was a long drive back to Kampala, and the mood in the van was somber, which wasn't helped by the fact we were driving in the dark.
Right, this is going to be a quick one tonight because I'm absolutely knackered. The radio station phoned in earlier. I've never wanted to grab a microphone more and speak, but I wasn't allowed because it might get us into trouble. Just a bunch of bigots, really, including the presenter. I thought he was supposed to be impartial on a talk show. But that drive we just did from Imbarara to Kampala, it's probably not even far, but the roads are so awful, and all of us in the car were just so tense and just wanted to get there safely. And there's these juggernauts coming towards us and missing us by this much. It's tiring me out.
I was nearing the end of my time in Uganda, but there was still one person I had to meet. And for someone like me, he was probably the most dangerous man in the country. Ugandan MP David Bahati, the man behind the anti-homosexuality bill. He's been demonized by the international community for proposing it, but applauded by his own countrymen, with 95% of Ugandans supporting some form of anti-gay law. The idea was to film him within the Parliament building. But at the last minute, we were told to leave, so had to hastily reconvene on the grass outside.
Could you describe this bill as homophobic?
I would describe it as a wonderful piece of legislation that will help those who are involved in this behavior, but also those who would, and protect those who are not involved in this.
But I've read a comment from you that you would like to kill every last gay person. Did you actually say that? And would you like that?
People keep on misquoting me about this issue. We have proposed a death penalty in this bill. But actually, we can rehabilitate these people and then they come back to normality. That's the path that we would be very much interested in.
What's the actual problem with being gay?
We believe that homosexuality is a learned behavior and can be unlearned. We also believe, backed by our background, that it is a sin, as stated in the Bible, as also stated in the Quran. And it's evil, it should be fought. It's not something good for our society.
But I've spoken to some people while I've been here who have to live in slums where they have to hide away from people, they've been harassed, and their lives have been made absolute hell. And this, if this bill goes through, then it's going to happen to so many more people.
Well, I can assure you that this has been, I think, a planned, deliberate propaganda by the gay movement to suggest that there has a lot of harassment here in Uganda. I've not seen any person being harassed.
But already parents are chasing children away from their homes.
Have you heard of that?
Yes.
I've not heard of that in this society. But
well, maybe you should do some more research.
But what I know is that once we have the legal framework passed, the bill passed, we'd expect a parent to report the child police, and then the law enforcement agencies should take care of that.
What about the people that totally believe that they were born gay and they can't change?
I would be very interested to meet somebody who says he's born gay. I've not heard of that.
Okay. I should probably tell you at this point that I am actually a gay man.
Mm.
How does that make you feel?
Well, I think if I had known, it would be a different matter for this interview.
You wouldn't have taken part in the interview?
No, I wouldn't.
Why?
I wouldn't.
Why?
No, I wouldn't.
But why?
And I think it's not professionally right to engage in this.
Okay. And well, I'm just asking you your views.
And if you are, we could probably ask our police to check if that's right.
Okay.
Make sure that you are not caught in the act, because if you are, you'll be put in.
No, I'm aware of that, yes. Okay.
It was then that David Bahati stopped the interview. As he did so, Steve, our driver, quickly told us we had to get going. He sensed something was very wrong, so we raced back to the hotel. We were told that David Bahati had sent police to a hotel he thought we were staying in to seize the tapes and arrest us. But luckily, he'd got it wrong.
I told Bahati I was gay earlier, and since then it's all gone off. He's been calling our fixer, asking where we're staying. He says that he's called the authorities, and I don't know, I'm just really scared now. I don't know what he's going to do. I've no idea what's going to happen. I'm expecting somebody to burst in through that door any minute and arrest me or something. I've never been in a situation like this before.
The first priority was to get the interview tape out of the country. And with the threat of arrest hanging over our heads, I was keen to leave Kampala too. But there was something I wanted to do first, so made one more trip to Boise.
Hi, how are you?
I'm okay, how
You're
are
okay?
you?
I'm good, thank you.
Hi.
I know it's not going to really help that much, but I've bought you a few little things.
Oh, thank you very much.
I bought you a stove. Yay! And I know that you said you needed some blankets and stuff.
Yeah, okay.
So I got you some blankets and some towels and some plates. We have them. and even some fox and spoons.
I didn't believe for a moment these gifts would change anything. Not why Ugandan society is so aggressive towards gay people.
Something happened to our friend. One of our friends was coming from out from the bar. Somebody came out from the other side of the road. He grabbed him. He was boxed. Then he fell down. Was like the kick. He was kicked.
So he was quite badly beaten up?
Yeah, he was quite beaten. He had some injuries around the lips here, and it was swelling like this. Then he was finding some difficulties in breathing, he was gasping for breathing.
Right. Do you think he was beaten up because he was gay?
Yeah, he was beaten because that guy who was beating him, he froze up with the boxing and the kicking with some words that, "I'm not a gay, why are you gay, why are you here, why are you here? I swear, I promise one time I will stay here, I will kill you, what?
It seemed every time I met them, something else bad had happened, which to me summed up the bigger picture. The homophobia never stops. But what's amazing is that through all this, Morgan, Joseph, and the others don't let it grind them down.
I was created in God's image. I know that I'm normal just like other people, and I know that I can succeed in life just like others. Yeah. I feel bad when they harass me, when they abuse me, but I don't think that's the I don't think that's the end of the world. I know it will be better some days. Yeah.
When I first arrived in Uganda, I was blown away by how vibrant, attractive, and full of life it seemed. But as I headed off to the airport and thought about my time here, I realised if it stayed like it is, I couldn't see myself ever wanting to come back.
People just think being gay is wrong, and not only just wrong, they hate them. They hate gay people, and, you know, I've spoken to people on the streets who think they should be killed, and pretty much everybody thinks the same thing. And all the time they've got pastors and teachers telling them that this is the way it is and that it's wrong and that it shouldn't be, then nothing's going to change, which is depressing.
But what it has done is made me realise how lucky I am.
My life actually isn't acceptable in some parts of the world, like here. And at home, I can live with who I want to live with, I can see who I want, I can go where I want. And to be honest, I've never really thought about it before, and I've probably taken it for granted. But I don't think I'll do that ever again.
Leaving her London home behind, Ju travels back to the Congo, a country she left when she was three. It's far from what she imagined, in the world's most dangerous place to be a woman, Thursday at 9. Next up on 3, the lockup.